IVM.
Hi and welcome to Toyo Kano. This is Amar from AM Rana Ventures and welcome to another edition where we have someone who's a restaurateur and entrepreneur and the host of the show Colaba Cartel, if I'm not wrong. And she is very well known amongst all you guys. And it's a pleasure and honor to have her on Noyo Kanoon now. Slowly, we're getting all the hosts to join on the legal side of things as a lawyer. So let's welcome Ms. Gauri Devidayal on the show. Welcome, Gauri. Thank you so much for being with us today. And on the weekend afternoon, I'm sure you were having a great time when we interrupted you and got you to come on this legal edition.
Not at all. Thanks for having me, Amber. And it's a welcome distraction from the rigors of restauranting. So, yeah.
No, absolutely. So, Gauri, today's episode is going to be pretty interesting. You know, I haven't had someone from the entrepreneur side of things in the F&B industry for a while where we haven't discussed about licensing, you know. And I've done a lot of licensing work for Central Excise, for customs, for manufacturing, etc. But F&B is the most heavily regulated, excise-ridden business, I suppose, in this country, which one can run. Correct?
Yes, licensing, you've dodged a bullet if you haven't yet had to deal with that. Yes.
So, you know, when I used to do taxation for a fair bit, I used to always have these manufacturers complain about, I have to get my excise thing done, I have to get this done, we used to process these files, etc. And then I had a couple of clients from F&B business as well, and I realized, what the hell, the manufacturers are having a good time. It's the F&B guys who have to run around the office with the files every now and then for some obsolete laws and for some laws which I also did not make sense of when I read them, being a lawyer and being a practicing lawyer. And when I read through those, I imagined that we do have a huge rule book, which I think should have been applicable elsewhere in other businesses. But I think just because nobody's cared enough to look into the F&B industry has been offloaded on entrepreneurs, which discourages them from even starting a business, you know. And the amount of corruption, I mean, I'm talking openly about it, the amount of bribes and corruption that go into running this, and that leads to fatalities and losing of life and property value, etc. So it's become a murky business from being a funny business and being an entertaining business. So let's start with that, Gauri. You've been into this for a while. For a while means a while, I suppose. So could you take us through your journey? Yes. So could you take us through
your journey? Very volatile, crazy years. Yeah. You know, you're absolutely right, Amber. And you know, I've seen this industry kind of grow, at least as far as Bombay is concerned, you know, over these 11 years, from being quite sort of nascent in the number of restaurants to what it is today, where, you know, you have a restaurant opening every week, if not every day. And, right. You know, at every sort of turn, you see a new restaurant or you see a restaurant. And so it's obviously... It's a kind of business that really draws tourism. It draws, you know, it's obviously promotes just social life. And it's a huge revenue churner for the government, whether it's through, you know, GST, VAT, excise, customs, whatever, right? So it's just in terms of employment, etc. It's a very integral part of the sort of ecosystem. And given all of this, it's just really, it's quite surprising how cumbersome the whole legal process is with setting up a business in this industry. And not just setting up, but then even continuing to operate it. And we've had our share of sort of crazy stories in this whole journey of running this business, because of the myriad sort of licenses and laws that, frankly, we didn't even know existed till someone came and like slapped a notice on our face. So so, you know, that's the thing that I don't think any restaurateur, no matter how long they've been in this business, has been able to get their head around.
No, absolutely, Gauri. I'll tell you what. Now, this is something with this I get a lot. So when I'm representing clients, you know, the only thing that I get from the authority side is you should have known the law of the land. Now, the problem is the law of the land is so articulated into different portions and hidden, and it's not easy to access. I can't go to a website somewhere and see where these hidden snippets of legislation are. But again, as a lawyer, if I have to say, I stand by the fact you should know the law of the land where you're entering into such kind of a thing. Now, my point to you is there are some laws which are very pertinent to the kind of work you want to do, which makes it more sane and civilized and easy for you to operate in. And then there are some laws which have been passed on to us as I would say, the British offloaded them, and we never tried to remove them from our system because we thought, well, let it be. It's a good way of
because we didn't know about them. Maybe
more of a Babu system in place. You know, it's better.
Yeah.
I'll maybe you'll go and meet the Babuji, and he'll give you'll offer 200-300 bucks. It's a good way of surplus income. You yeah. also earn, and he'll also earn. You know, that whole Sarkari Raj concept did not die down in the F&B industry, and it's huge in India. The problem is this industry is literally huge. The bars, the restaurants, everything, the modern life.
It is.
It is huge.
Thing. I mean, I'll give you an example, Amber. Like we, you know, there's one law which relates to weights and measures. And
right.
every year you have to buy a peg measure that has been, which comes with a certificate from this whatever department that yes. issues it. And it's some like arbitrary body that, you know, I mean, doesn't have any other purpose but to issue weight, to issue peg measures
yeah.
every year
yeah.
to
yeah.
License bar. And it's just crazy. It's like, you know, I could still be serving less than the peg measure, you know, if I was really trying to swindle guests, right? But instead, I have to dish out a certain amount of money and get a certified peg measure every year. And, you know, I mean, it's and of course, you know, they'll come and check it and, you know, you sort of have it even if you don't want to use it because you're not able to run a bar with one peg measure, right? So,
of course. Yeah, as a standard, you know what, this is what, so when I compare jurisdictions, right, I compare the Indian jurisdiction on F&B, it's also of a kind that, you know, this business has not been literally taken as a business. The misconception, the confusion around it, the whole business is so murky because right now as a vertical, this has not been simplified and broken down for ease of doing business because it also falls under the state excise and the state matter. I think that is the division.
Yeah, so there's part of it, you know, which is run by the
yes,
state and part
yes,
is central. So
yes.
there's a lot of like
conflict.
Sides don't talk to each other
yes,
sometimes.
Sides don't
and,
talk
yeah.
to each other and they don't give you. I mean, you might have an approval from center, but what if the state officials just say no to you or do not agree with what they've given? They might say center said yes, but you're governed by our policies. You know, on that, there is a jurisdictional issue, correct? I understand. But also, I'll also talk about, you know, the facilities available to run these places, like somewhere like Bombay, where you're constrained for space. Legally speaking, those places were never meant to run a commercial business. But those licenses being issued to make them commercial, I understand, you know, time, things progress. But having the health, safety, etc. in place, and then you have these EHS and, you know, environment, health, safety, fire safety, etc.
You
then
need to
these,
get like traffic,
yeah,
NOCs,
traffic,
you need to get NOCs, you need to,
NOCs.
And you're absolutely right. Like a lot of spaces are not
right.
conducive to getting that.
Right.
Like you don't, for example, we don't have like massive parking in front
right.
on the main road
right.
in front of
right.
our restaurant, but
right.
I have to have supposedly enough parking to cater
absolutely.
To all the foot. Yeah.
Yeah. And well, there should be designated areas then where you allow the business, you want the money from the businesses to pour in into this industry, and then you don't provide the right infrastructure. Now, somebody had compared this to me by saying that in Italy, this is what happens. I said, you know, well, don't compare Italy and India. Don't compare India, Bangladesh. Don't compare us. We're a population of over 1 billion. Italy has a population of roughly 20 million, I suppose, right? And then you're not allowed to take your cars in. How do you apply? So, stuff like this I keep out of the legal ambit. What I try to compare is the ease of doing business as we talk about it. You know, how can you do it? How can it be simplified? I remember there are different colored slips you have. Pink slip, green slip, an environment, and there's a yellow slip. And you collate these and put in a folder and God knows which slip is what. They're into local lingos. Then they are also in Hindi, then in Marathi. Then you take all of them and submit this. There's a huge bunch of file that goes in. First, you need to
love our paper. What can
you
I
love
say,
your
right?
paperwork, right? What do you have to say about that? Has anything gone online? Then I'll then highlight some.
You
of
know,
the-
so a few things have, and a few, if not the application process, the renewal process, where you're just paying a certain fee and possibly having to upload certain documents to ensure that you're still in, you know, you're still sort of ticking various boxes. That has, but you know, I have to tell you something really funny. When a lot of the government websites, which are, you know, trying to go online with these processes, I don't know what browser they're using, but I remember for one of them, I had to download an archaic browser just to be able to access this one website. And then the other thing is that when you're uploading documents, you have to shrink them to a size where they're virtually illegible, just so that you can upload them within the size restrictions of these government websites. So, you know, it's like, yes, I really appreciate the fact that they're going, they're making an attempt to go digital, but you have to kind of also upgrade and, you know, move with the time. Let's not get into what's happening to the income tax website, but it's kind of like that sort of situation. And then, of course, there is a lot of resistance from the authorities to go digital, because then you're cutting out that Babu system that you talked about.
Of course.
But, you know, I just want to add to what you said earlier about the ease of doing business and knowing the law, and, you know, ignorance is not an excuse. I completely agree with that. So, you know, I have a legal background as well. I studied law and I worked for nine years as a tax consultant. So I'm sort of, you know, aware that you can't hide behind, you know, that ignorance excuse. But I will caveat that you need to make those laws available and accessible to people. And then if you say that, listen, it's all there, if you just bother to check in one place, you know, then of course that excuse is not viable. But when it's like, I don't even think the authorities themselves know, you know, what all the laws possibly are. And then to expect sort of someone new entering this business to have that information is even less, you know, likely.
No, very rightly put, Gauri. I'll also state that US is not very far ahead of us. They also have such obscene laws. I remember, I think it was in Texas or Colorado, there is a state law where I had gone with someone and online, and we were reading about, because my counterpart was appearing there, and he forwarded a copy of it. It was that if there is litter on the road and you kick it, you can be imprisoned or fined for some amount of dollars. And there was just an empty Coke can, which was apparently out of the bin, which had fallen down on the footpath. And the gentleman, while walking, just tried to shift it, and the cops got hold of him, and he was fine.
No kidding.
So it's just not India. It's also.
Let's not put this on the public record. They find one more thing to add here that they've missed out on.
and some of the gruesome ones that, you know, I'm sure entrepreneurs are scared of in India. Let me highlight them. I don't know if you've known them. I spoke to you off record about them. One was license for a chimney and a smoke nuisance act. This is new to me. I read about it only 6 months back. Then there is a license for running a mixer and a grinder if you're using phase 3 power, and permission from the police for a bar. So police needs to, of course, police permission is separate for a bar. I understand. But what about rest of the restaurant? Now, as far as, you know, some of the other funny ones that I want to tell you, you know, when they're concerned, is one is performance license. If you have someone performing. God.
That is a scam, dude. That is a serious scam. Yeah.
There is.
And one sec. So performance includes playing licensed music.
Yes. What is unlicensed music? I want to understand from you. Is it ripoff or copy? What do they call unlicensed?
Who even does that anymore? Do you like download? Like, do you even do that? I don't even know how to do that. I don't have the time. I'm like trying to run a serious business here, guys. It's really not like my priority to download illegal, whatever, unlicensed music to play in my restaurant, which, by the way, is actually my main business.
Right. Yeah. And you know, this was one. Then I want your view on one more, which is, you know, a license for generators. Now, I understand boilers and generators that for an establishment that is massive, there is a requirement that you have them there. But don't you think that if for all of this, there was one single form that you needed to fill and there was a division created, would it make easier for you to actually get all of these in? And you would also know what needs to be done rather than every step.
We live in massive amounts of hope.
Yeah. So I want your view on this. You know why? Because, see, you're running a business that has music, that has entertainment, that has, of course, you would have different nights to have different kinds of crowd here. You would run a small bakery. I don't know whether you do or not, but I haven't visited Bombay in a while. Yeah, absolutely. So then you need that central excise license for bakery as well, though it's got nothing to do with liquor and stuff in it, but due to you might using rum in cakes and yeast and everything, you know, that's how it's correlated. Don't you think, and as an entrepreneur, that, you know, if I say, Corey, do you want to expand this business into 3 more restaurants or 4 more restaurants? What would be your take on that? Like when you say, like, if you
so you know what they say, right? Don't wish a restaurant on your worst enemy. Or that's what you would tell your worst enemy to do, is get into the restaurant business. No, you know, it's this weird thing where every new project we do, I'm like cursing. And at the same time, it's this weird, obviously, this weird addiction that we have, right, as restaurateurs to, you know, do new things and keep sort of taking advantage of opportunities that arise. But it comes with all this, you know, this awful pain of, you know, compliance that is just, it just sort of kills the fun of doing, right, this business. And, you know, you, right, forgot one earlier one where you had to have your liquor permit, right? Every individual had to, yes, like have their, yeah, like liquor annual, yes, liquor permit, which we were supposed to, yes, check, or we were supposed to give it to people for one day, every day. And, you know, it's just, I completely understand the, right, need for regulation and, you know,
keep it healthy.
Sort of, yeah, yeah, I completely, like, health, safety, all of that. I just don't understand why it's not being sort of made more conducive to actually running the business, which is what's generating all of this, you know, revenue for the state or the central government. So I really can't. And I think one of the things is, you know, which we also kind of felt a lot during this whole lockdown phase where, you know, the industry really felt like, right, we hadn't got any support, is that I think that this, the whole restaurant industry is seen as a luxury. It's seen as an indulgence. You know, it's seen as not a necessity for people to have, and therefore it doesn't need to be sort of, you know, propped up with any kind of support, whether it's, you know, in terms of reducing compliance, whether it's in terms of, you know, any kind of financial sort of subsidies or anything. So, which is really sad because, you know, we've just reopened in Bombay for lunch service. And, you know, it's like, it feels like the floodgates have opened for people to come, be coming out again. And it just goes to show how integral it is to a city and, you know, the whole sort of, I guess, culture, right? The sort of the social cultural aspect of a city. So I really hope in my lifetime it reaches a point where it is a smoother process. It's a, you know, this ease of doing business is sort of a reality for us. But right now it seems like
you forgot one very interesting piece of legislation. I'll highlight the Maharashtra Pollution Control Board also, you know.
And what have I not done? Please tell me.
You are not keeping your emissions in check apart from the chimney in place. That is one of the things they come up to you and tell you that the pollution control.
No, I'm like, you know what? Restaurants actually generate so much, you know, garbage, right? Both recyclable and non.
Right,
and
right.
There's like no initiative to like segregate and use this. So it's like there's so much good that can actually come out of this whole, you know, out of the working with the local sort of authorities. And that's not happening. But what is happening is kind of like, you know, it's like, how can I make your life harder than it already is? You know, that's the goal.
You know, the BMC had proclaimed that they waived off 22 crores or 23 crores of property tax.
They've just said they're increasing property taxes like 3 days ago.
In COVID-19 crisis. And there was also a statement that, you know, due to the FAST Act of the Municipal Corporation, out of 22,000 restaurants, 14,000 could come back to life. But I also read a statistics which says that about 60 odd lakh people lost their lives alone in, lost their livelihoods alone in Maharashtra itself.
Yeah.
Because of the restaurant business going out of stuff. So, do you think that's happening in reality? Do you think 14,000 restaurants have opened up here?
No, I mean, you know, I know, I mean, my sort of friends in the fraternity who've had to close down. And you know, what's really interesting is that, speaking of regulation and all of that, is that, I don't know if I don't have these numbers on my fingertips, but like the size of the disorganized or the unorganized industry versus the organized sector, which gets like all this like scrutiny and, you know, requirements to comply. versus, you know, this unorganized sector, which is completely like, you know, unregulated, is what's really shocking is that, you know, like the and then, of course, now and I have nothing against them. Like, I'm completely sort of pro entrepreneurship. But like, you know, there's a number of home chefs that have like, you know, erupted, obviously, during lockdown. And it's great, like the amount of, you know, variety and choice and the quality that's coming out. But then again, like, you know, it's always restaurants that are held to this like really high standard of compliance versus like everybody else who's operating quite freely and, you know, without this, the joys of compliance. Yeah.
No, and you know, I think the FSSAI, FSSAI, that I call it FSSAI because it gets people stuck. The FSSAI license, the Golden Jubilee license that you need. I had a client who was getting some cheese imported from somewhere in Greece. And this license put their lives into jeopardy, literally. The packaging, and it was not that they're importing 150 kilos or 300 kilos or pallets of 800 kilos or 900 kilos. They were just getting a sample of 60 kilos in to try if it works. And it took them 35 days. And then I had to write, you know, to ask them that, sir, what is it that is causing this delay? Now, if the average entrepreneur who wants to start something like this in an industry like cheese, because they were getting some vegan cheese and other stuff into it, which the authorities never knew of, so they never accorded them the license itself, saying that what kind of business is this? And then the customs came up saying, I don't know whether you fall under cheese or not. And then every one of the departments woke up and that cheese became the bone cheese. It never reached to us.
That's so sad.
Prevented it from doing so. So, you know, stuff like this, of course, as you say,
no, and also, you know, you have, you know, speaking of that, you have to understand. So we went through this a few years ago where we serve a lot of imported wine. And the thing is that you can't force people into serving domestic by banning imported, right? Like, you have to make everything available and let people choose. And of course, we serve domestic wine as well. But so they were requiring wine bottles to be relabled with, and I think they have to have the label in Hindi as well as English, and then certain thing about the ingredients, etc. to be listed, which I mean, obviously more than what was already being done. And a lot of, I was chatting with, you know, again, friends in the industry who are in the import business, and they were just saying that, you know, the producers wherever in the world, like what they're sending to India is such a small quantity, they don't care like enough to sit there and like create new labels.
Doesn't matter.
You know? Yeah. Yes. So it's just crazy because it just feels like it's anti-industry and you know, this legislation, and, you know, and I completely understand like wanting there to be more transparency and wanting sort of, you know, but the problem is that because they're not part of the industry, they're not able to keep up with the changes. So, you know, like what you're talking about, vegan cheese, and then, oh, is that considered dairy? But it's not dairy. So then, you know, is it really cheese? And, you know, understanding how sort of products are evolving and trying to be able to keep up is just not happening.
Yes. And, you know, it is where I think we roughly even constitute 2% of any major producer of any of these items we've spoken of. They really don't care about 100 kilos coming to India, but getting them in. And now, my experience working with a dear friend who's a celebrity chef, Harsh Dixit. You know, I work with him. He's in Bombay. He does a lot of this good work. He was working on a project. I was working with him and I had some great food. And he started telling me that how he's so restricted when he wants to really produce something from a cuisine and wants to offer it to his audience, and how he has to just literally bang his head on the wall to get stuff in.
I have to tell you this really funny story. And on the same thing, there was a wine importer who was importing this. I think it was an Italian label, and it had a drawing of a woman and with rather like voluptuous breasts. And they required him to color the drawing in on the label so that it didn't look obscene. I know, and I was just like, okay, are you kidding? You just like colored over a wine producer's label to get those bottles through. I mean, you know, it's just, I mean, we're laughing right now, but it's not very funny when you're going through it.
Somebody's business is being taken for a toss just because you think, you know, well, this is how the ideology is going to be. Now, even on that topic of obscenity, you know, I don't get into it because it's such a thin line of difference in India and understanding what is obscene and what is not obscene and in which scenario it is obscene, God knows, and how they work. But I think there is a lot of such changes required. In fact, I remember when this FSSAI license was being accorded to restaurant owners for importation, there was one requirement which was related to water testing report being coming from ISI approved facility. Now, for a restaurant whose turnover, and I'm going to use specific terms, let's say it's just 36 lakhs, okay, turnover, we're starting out. Imagine for them to have and they were working on imports, like someone like a Modern Bazaar who's importing stuff, and now they have a cooking station, etc. Imagine getting license and everything in place. By the time he does that, the amount of money he's picked from the market and the amount of losses they bear till the time these licenses come in, you can put your stuff on hold, but then your launch goes for a toss in your business. Whereas if it was a factory or it was a manufacturing unit, maybe you could just go scot-free by paying a certain amount of penny, and then nobody will come and check your drainage if it's dirty, or whether you're washing linen or you're throwing alcohol down the drain. But, for a small business owner, there should be incentives, because that is how he'll become big and contribute to the economy. And that's some of the problems that I've seen. You know, medical certificates of employees, now I can recall some of them. Food.
Yeah, we have to do nokarnamas. We have to do and then I remember this medical certificate thing that the hospitals kept saying, we're not, and then the BMC would say, you have to go to this hospital, and the hospital would be like, but we're not doing this. And then they'd be like, oh, wow. But you have to go there. And they'd be like, but we're not doing this. And we're like, nobody's talking to each other. Yeah.
There's no update as to the panel of physicians and stuff you need to head to get this done.
Exactly.
NOCs that you need, from... I had once an experience with a dhaba, which got very famous in some part of this country, north. And it was not a dhaba. It was technologically a running seven-star restaurant, I would rather say. But it used to be called... It was a dhaba of a sort that we used to say. And there was somebody from the food and regulation that day there. And when we entered the kitchen, and he said, you know what the shocking part is? He's like, our traditionally homegrown restaurants are much better than a KFC or a McDonald's. And if you go and check out their health safety norms, and I can just, I'm not commenting that, McDonald's is bad. I'm using someone else's pretext and explaining that he was saying that traditionally corporate guys, their stuff, we don't know what's happening, but they have their approvals in place. And he says that is why you see
the irony.
So he was saying, but just because it's a corporate, the irony, it's a corporate, it has a team that does the paperwork. So it becomes easier to approve and get everything in order. Whereas when it comes to someone like you or me, who's going to start something of an idea, it becomes a tedious job.
Look, I mean, you're absolutely right. Like, I think that, I'm not saying that we're completely innocent and that, I know that, like, even during this whole, like, COVID period when, we were allowed to reopen and we had to comply with certain, mandates in terms of capacity and things like that. I mean, I know that there are restaurants that flouted those norms, and that's not acceptable at all. So I'm not trying to say there shouldn't be regulation or that we're completely we have no part to play in all of this, but I just think that for those who do want to comply and follow the law and run a successful business, it should be, like you said earlier, there should be an ease in being able to do that, which is just missing right now.
So I think if you can maybe count on the back of your hand, how many licenses did you apply for when you started this? I want young entrepreneurs to know from this.
I don't even have enough hands and toes and feet and whatever for this. Honestly, I don't even know, because they've cropped up over the years.
Roughly 70, I suppose. Roughly around 70 or 80.
I don't think it's maybe 70, but between getting NOCs and, all of that, when you finally get the license that required about 10 NOCs, if you count all of that, it definitely crosses about 50.
So, yes, sir, on an average, you need to have at least 60 in place. So you're roughly correct. We give you the prize for remembering at least 50 for minimum, because that's the basic 50 we need.
Yeah, right? if you factor in everything from HR related to
60, 70 licenses.
Operating to everything.
Yes. And you start applying under, so many different heads and so many departments, collating them. But I think this year they dropped some licenses. Especially
I haven't felt the benefit of it, I have to admit.
Maybe, Gauri, when you're doing your next application, I'll help you join in and say, hey, you had said about 10 licenses are dropped.
Maybe we can file a PL.
So the good news coming right right away is that the registration under Weights and Measurement Act will go away in person. I think it's going to go online. That is one of the good news. I have the
notification. Oh, I thought you
meant it's going to go away. It's kind of a going away in a way that they will scrap it completely. It's in the notification. Performance license is going to go. License for mixer and grinder, this chimney, and I think the hotel one, the license for hotel or something, that has to go. Boiler, generator, I remember. And then I think for bakery products, the central excise license will go away, and cold storage license. So these 10 out of the 60 can be said thank you to. It will shift to online or maybe get scrapped completely. That is what the buzz is currently. To promote the industry to go forward, they've done an audit, I suppose, and we found that these are the 10 dangerous ones that are causing problem to people. So they've got to be shelved so that more entrepreneurs come in. I can talk about Canada, though, that I have known the regime, tax regime, and how it works. The amount of subsidy incentivization they have given to food and culinary business owners is tremendous. Laws in place, absolutely correct. But everything is just so organized. I have worked with some of them on international transactions. It is just so smooth. Yeah. My own experience as a lawyer, I would say even in Australia, New Zealand, which are hubs of F&B industry, and Canada, was that in 24 hours, you could just literally file for an application for a license. And it takes about 6 days max for you to get everything sorted and the approvals coming in. If we have that, it takes, I don't know, it has taken 3 months also for some of the people I know to even get 10 licenses in place.
No, we took 8 months to get our excise license when we first opened our restaurant. So we had to get a day license every single day.
So that's that. And I think all we can say is that, guys, if you want to open a restaurant business, please hear Gauri's podcast. And she will.
By the way, my other podcast. Oh, yeah. So the Kulaba Cartel is about, like, it's 10 episodes of why you don't want to open a restaurant, basically.
And then another one also. Yes, there's another one.
So this, it's called, the one that's currently going is called This Round Is On Me, which is basically my way of escaping from the restaurant business. So I talk to everyone other than people in the restaurant industry. And
please do listen in, because Gauri's got some really good experiences she's going to share with you guys, being a restaurant. And you could learn a lot from an experienced restaurant than a lawyer, because for me, it's all about making money, guys. So I will give you as many licenses as needed, but Gauri will tell you the right way to go forward. Gauri, it was a pleasure chatting with you. Thank you so much for being on Know Your Kanun. And we hope to have more such interactions with you. And maybe we'll now start picking up these licenses and discussing about them at length with you. You know, let's go industry-wise. And
I think we should have an annual catch-up where we talk about all the licenses that have actually gone and keep count.
And keep the industry updated, you know, help the people out and disseminate information. And maybe someday when this COVID goes away, I'll be Gauri's restaurant having a nice meal to myself and talking about this and posting it to you guys out there. Yes, Gauri. Thank you so much, Gauri, for being here. It was wonderful chatting with you. I hope you enjoyed it.
Thanks so much. Thanks so much for having me, Amber.
I hope you enjoyed that show. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Like to thank the sponsors on the network this week, Cred and Sia. Thank you so much for making this possible. We've had an amazing week on the network. Do check out The Note with Maruki Nayak. She speaks to Prabhat Kumar, the man leading child protection at one of India's leading NGOs, Save the Children. On The Habit Coach, Ashton was joined by Rajat Mittal Shah to talk about some superfoods in Ayurveda like turmeric and ashwagandha. On Paisa Vaisa, host Anupam Gupta has a digital gold special in two parts, one with Ashraf Rizvi, founder and CEO of Digital Swiss Gold and Gilded, and one with Deepak Abbott, co-founder of India Gold. Listen to the first part of the Father's Day special of Agla Station Adulthood with Natasha and her father, Dr. Vipul Roy Rathore. You should also check out Cyrus Says' episode with Mukul Chadda. He talks about upcoming shows Sunflower and Sherni. Our Kannada podcast, Thalayorates, celebrates 100 episodes, and we had a reunion of hosts Pawan, Ganesh, and Surya, who shared their favorite moments from the past. Shiva Mehta is back with the second season of Smile India. The show is available in both English and Hindi. On this episode, she talks about the conversion from bag teas to bagless ones and how we should ditch the plastic and have a great tea experience. And with that, I hope to see you again next week.
Hi, I am Sadaf.
And I'm Arshit. Khane ka itihas, economics, policy, psychology,
सब है मेन्यू पे. ओनली ऑन द नानकाली पॉडकास्ट एवरी वेडनेसडे सिर्फ IVM पॉडकास्ट ऐप या वेबसाइट पर या फिर जहां से भी आप अपने पॉडकास्ट सुनते हो.